everybody. Welcome aboard. Happy Saturday. It's good to see all you guys. Pee Wee Sweden, it's good to see you as well, sir. It's been a good day. It's been a real good day. Had a little flight lesson this morning. Things went super well. The weather was fantastic. It was like 40, 45 degrees Fahrenheit when we took off. It was probably 60, 65 once we got done by the time I got home. I got my shorts on. It's a nice day outside. I'm going to go have a cigar, I think, once we're done with this whole thing. And right now I'm sitting here with my brewski and a couple of gentlemen here is going to join us. So today we're going to talk to the FlightSimCon team, who at the moment happens to be Evan. I've got Evan Reiter, and I've got Jeff Fabiano with us, who's going to talk about the event here. So let me bring these guys in very slowly.
Microphone activated.
There we go. You guys there?
Oh, yeah.
Hello. Say hi. So, hey, everybody knows hello. Jeff. Say hi, Jeff.
Hello.
And now everybody can know. Mine's
always lit up because of the noise gate, just so you know.
Oh, okay. I was wondering, I'm like, what the hell? Like, are we going to have some crazy, like, I don't know.
No.
I was wondering what was going on there. And then say hello, Evan.
How you doing, guys?
So, Evan, real quick, let's start off with what you're doing. What are you here for?
Absolutely. Well, I'm here to talk FlightSimCon. I've been part of the FlightSimCon team now basically since the beginning of the event, attended every single one of them, and my primary role has been trying to help get as many exhibitors, sponsors, speakers, and folks out to this event as possible. So I'm here today to try and do a little more of that.
Awesome. And we're glad to have you here.
Yeah, good to be here.
So if you guys have been living under a rock, FlightSimCon is it's a pretty cool little event. There's a bunch of us going to be out there. Not only is it a cool event that we're going to be out there, but we're also going to be live streaming from the event too. So I'm heading out there Friday, the day before FlightSimCon, start setting up a whole bunch of gear. And then Saturday and Sunday, myself and Mr. Fabiano and Mr. Durka Durka and Mr. A whole bunch of other people are going to be live. We got a bunch of guys that are coming out, and we'll be live showing various sims and various things throughout the course of the weekend. And we're hoping to get some developers that will swing by and say hello. So if you can't make it,
that should be a good time.
It should be a good time. If you can't make it, we can at least get you in one way or another, and you can kind of see what you're missing out on. And if you can't make it, then you know, stop by, see, and you can see how the sausage is made. Because I'm basically going to have my whole damn setup there, for better or worse. All the crap that I'm staring at right now, and I'm getting palpitations thinking about bringing all that stuff out there.
Oh yeah.
So here's what's going to happen. We're going to talk a little bit about the event. I am going to fly the Airfoil Lab Cessna 172, probably quite poorly.
I think you'll do good now. I mean, actually training in a 172 now.
I am a certified Cessna 172 student pilot right now for whatever
See,
that's
exactly.
worth.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So now you're gonna know what it's like to be on the other side of the actual sim. And to me, the Airfoil Labs is probably the absolute best.
Yeah, dude.
When
it's
it comes
pretty good.
I mean, it stalls correctly and everything else, and I've never had anything do it the way it does.
Before we start talking about the event here, the first thing I got to do is see if I can turn it on. So
yeah, I think you can,
Evan. If you can bear with me for a moment, this is always the hardest part of this plane, because I don't really know what the hell I'm doing.
Yeah, no worries. It's been a long time since I've flown a 172, and I've never flown one newer than the 1970s. So don't worry about it.
All right, spikes.
I'm watching you on a delay,
Beacon,
so it works out. I'll be real
nav, and we got this. We got the throttle in there. We got the fuel shutoff valve. Fuel shutoff valve is off.
Yep.
If you pull
Which is
it,
pushed
it,
in.
So you push it in, and that means we got gas.
Yep.
All right, we'll see what happens.
Pull it off, we'll shut it off. So you don't want to do that. But a lot of people think that since it should be off, they would think it would be the opposite. But
spoilers.
Yeah.
It started. All right, so let me
figure
out.
Yeah, we should just spike the fuel pump to point, what is it, to 5 gallons per hour, whatever what it is.
Cool.
There is a 0.5. I can't remember the gauge, but.
Yeah. Where's the damn wind? There's no windsock here.
And I've got to say, you know, I've been to quite a few different conventions, and the FlightSimCon is like one of our favorite ones. Like, we've only been to it once, but it is one of our favorite ones, myself and Nicole, because they're an extremely fun group of people.
Absolutely. And Evan, we'll jump the gun here a little bit. We'll jump the gun in a moment. How do I turn my transponder on? Uh-oh.
Duke Demon, yeah, that is the one, the only Evan Reiter.
It is.
Well, they said he's the best Boston center on VATSIM.
The best Boston center. Evan, you know, Evan, I don't think I've ever had you as a controller on VATSIM.
Lucky you.
yeah, I actually flew into Boston on stream a couple weeks ago. We flew through We flew through LaGuardia. It was when LaGuardia had their FNO about two weeks ago. And LaGuardia was a bit of a... It was interesting.
I don't think I can say anything on recording or on record about my colleagues in New York Center. I think I'm gonna get myself in trouble if I do that.
Yeah, no, don't do that.
Yeah, we're good friends with New York. We love those guys. We always love supporting their events. I think I couldn't make it that night, so I missed out on that one. But I heard good things. It was busy.
Yeah, it was stupid busy, and the weather was awful too.
Yeah, and LaGuardia is a tough airport. Like, I think their arrival rate's like 28 an hour in bad weather, and I'm sure it was easily double that. So it would have been a challenging airspace to work for sure.
Did you strike that 152 sitting there?
I might have. Don't worry about it, dude. Don't judge. I don't know. I can't
actually...
You're
on thin ice after last night.
Oh, there we can turn a transponder on. Okay. yeah, so I'm kind of curious, before we do a little bit of FlightSimCon talk, and if you want to talk about Boston Virtual and kind of what you guys do.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, we're the bats in Boston Virtual ARTCC. As far as we know, we're the only community on the entirety of Batson that has both pilots and controllers as members. And we've done that very specifically because we think there's no reason for them to be separate. I mean, basically, the controllers and the pilots learn from each other. And that's what we're really all about at Batson. So we're a community now of about 4,000 members in total, about 100-ish controllers. And then the rest are all pilot members. You know, most of them fly on Batson. Lots of them fly other places, too. And, of course, we don't expect people that just fly in our airspace. But we've got lots of things that are specific about our airspace that our members will use. So we've got a number of cool training programs, pilot ratings program, for example, which you may have heard of, got our own virtual airline, Cape Air Virtual, those kinds of things. So we're our own little mini community within Batson, and then of course we cater to the Batson public, so to speak, as well.
Interesting. I didn't know you guys had a virtual airline.
That's right, yeah. It's very small. It's designed to be replicating the real-world Cape Air. So we've got operations in Boston. They do a little bit outside of the Boston, some of the other areas that the real-world Cape Air does, but primarily it's a Boston-based thing. So it's neat because you'll end up working center. You've got a whole bunch of these jetliners coming in from New York or wherever, and then there's like these little twin prop jobs that you've got to try and sequence in between them into Boston. It's really quite fun.
Nice. That's pretty cool. Ooh, you guys pretty regularly win the Iron Mike Award, don't you?
Yeah, we've been doing pretty well for staffing. We won Golden Mike last year. Haven't been keeping too close tabs on it. It's not something we try to do. It's just something that kind of happens, which is kind of interesting. And so we just are there because we like doing it. You know, whenever we staff up, it seems like we're busy. Whenever we do an event, it seems like we're real busy, sometimes too busy. So it's real good fun. And for folks who are interested, you know, there's no commitment or anything like that. Of course, it's free to be part of the community. So if you're ever interested, our website is just bvartcc.com, or you can find us at bostonvirtualartcc.com as well, and all the information about how to join and stuff like that is up there. Basically, the only thing we ask people to do is just complete a simple exam, and the idea is we want people to make sure that they've got a basic level of understanding. I wish that's something that Batson did with our pilot members as well, is just have people go through some of the simplest things, like how do you connect, and what software do you use, and who do you talk to, like just some of those simple questions. That's what's in our exam. We want to make sure people have that base level of understanding, and then once they get in, we've got a whole bunch of interesting, and as I say, very valuable training programs, the pilot rating program probably being the biggest one of all them.
Well, if you want to talk about the exam, I passed the exam, so that tells you a lot about it. No problems, guys. Piece of cake. But no, I joined you guys, I think around the time that we started talking about setting this whole thing up. Actually, it might have been last year. I'm not really sure. But I don't do a lot of my flying on VATSIM, so unfortunately, I don't get to come out and hang out with you guys too often, but I suspect we're going to be doing a little more of it as we come up to June.
Yeah, I think so. We're going to certainly have a big presence at the conference, BVA, or as I like to call it. We've always had a big presence at that event. I think last year we had like over 50 people there. And so we do a lot of the support work. I mean, some of our guys were helping with registration. We were moving tables around, getting the setup organized in the first place. And then, of course, we also do our own demonstration there. And the purpose of that is to just show the general public who maybe doesn't know what is FlightSim or how does it work. We want to show people that you can actually sit in your home and you can log in and connect. And all of a sudden, here's Boston Center, here's Boston Approach. For people like us, I mean, we all know and we all get it. But for people who have only flown a real airplane, never seen a sim, it's really neat for them to actually be able to physically see. It's like, okay, this is the pilot, and over here, here's the controller, and here's that little dot on the screen that's the pilot.
Now, do you guys get a lot of real pilots that are coming in?
We do. I would say most of our membership in the community, probably about 60 to 70% we figure now, are either student or higher. Okay. And then at FlightSimCon, it's about a 50-50 split. So 50% people that are there that are pilots that also know FlightSim, and then about 50% of the people there that have never really flown, but that do it because they like the experience or they're able to, you know, replicate the tube-liner kind of experience.
That's pretty cool, man. Yeah, it's I do a lot of my pilot flying over on Pilot Edge, and it's crazy the number of real pilots that are actually in the simulator. But like as I'm going through my primary training and kind of interacting with, you know, the folks out in like the real flying world, if you will, it's also crazy how many folks have no idea that the sims really exist. Like they all seem to think the sims are what they flew back in the 80s, and it's like it's such a vastly different experience nowadays.
Yeah, I totally agree.
And I can tell you like firsthand like what a huge difference it makes. Even though like I'm super 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 early on in my training, like what an enormous difference it's made flying my sim and flying my sim online. Just understanding like there's so much stuff that I understand that I don't have to be explained, or they'll explain it once. I'm like, yeah, I got that. We're fine. I radio calls, no problem. I got that. And
I think that's
cool.
A big part of what the conference is trying to do as well, is we're mm-hmm. trying to show the real world groups, whether it be pilots, whether it be controllers, whether it be the FAA, we're trying to show everyone that there's real potential here. And I think we've seen that the FAA in particular has been slow to recognize that what FlightSim is able to do for people goes beyond just people with a joystick at a computer. And not only for pilots, but also for controllers. I mean, here we are with a giant controller shortage. We're in a situation where we're having a lot of trouble recruiting new controllers, a lot of trouble training the folks that do get recruited. Meanwhile, on VATSIM or on Pilot Edge or on IVAO, you've got hundreds of people who do this voluntarily. So why don't you look to that as a place to say, you know what, these people already kind of know what they're doing. They definitely want to do it. Let's maybe give them some training and see what happens.
Yeah, I agree. That's pretty cool. And I it's interesting to think about it from the controller's side of things. Like I know that there's a few pilotage controllers who have gone on to become real world controllers, and it's interesting to think that like we think of like I think the flying is being something that I can learn, but the controllers can definitely get some good skills out of it too.
That's right. Yeah, we've had several from VATSIM, same story. In fact, I've got at least two from the group that I have right now at Boston Virtual ARTCC that are in the process with the FAA right now.
That's
and
pretty cool.
In fact, we tell them and a lot of the folks that are controllers basically say, when you're going through your training at the academy, don't mention VATSIM because they don't want to hear about it. And I think that's totally wrong. Now, when you get to the facilities and you go to A90 or you go to Boston Center in the real world, they're all about it. But for whatever reason, at the academy, you start talking VATSIM and it's a dirty word.
That's kind of crazy. Well, it's the same thing with pilots. Like with pilots, you start talking about the flight sims, you're like, okay. Again,
well, that's because if you say I do flights and they think you just have like a joystick at home and you just you don't know anything what you're doing. They don't know what level of flight simming you're doing.
Yeah, and like I flew with a real world pilot today who's not an instructor, and he complimented me on my flying skills. And it's like, well, that's cool. I have 4.9 hours, but I have 3,000 hours in a sim.
Yeah.
The biggest thing
about sims, what it does is it makes you an IFR pilot more so than a VFR pilot. And the only way you're going to get VFR is by actually doing it in a real airplane.
Yep.
Which you are learning. And it's weird because you're like, you don't have to look at your instruments so much. And you're so used to your instrument scan that you do in a sim.
Oh, that's cool. Busted Minimum. Busted Minimum says his CFI is a simmer. Was stoked that he had prior experience. That's cool. That's cool to hear stuff like that. Like I was talking to my instructor today, and I asked him about ForeFlight and the iPad, and if he objected to me having it. He's like, as long as it's not a distraction. But the dude still uses it. The dude has the whole airspace memorized around Boston because he's just like, do that frequency, that frequency, that frequency. I'm looking over like, where's your chart at?
He says memorized.
So why don't we talk about the event a little bit? So we've got you here. You got FlightSimCon coming up. Like this is definitely as Flight SciTech said on the way in here today. This is a little bit of a hashtag ad, but I think it's a good discussion to have because I don't know that you guys are getting a whole lot of like this type. I don't know how much of this type of airtime you're getting. So why don't we start off talk about the conference? Talk about what's going on, what your target is, and who you'd like to have show up.
Yes, we're FlightSimCon. You can see our website, FlightSimCon.com. And we're looking at June 10th and 11th at Bradley Airport. So if you guys know the area, BDL, Bradley Airport, that's where we're going to be. It is Windsor Longs, Connecticut. It's about a 20-minute drive north of Hartford, Connecticut, basically halfway between Boston and New York, for those of you who don't know the U.S. all that well. We're hosting the event this year at the Sheraton Hotel, so that's right on the airport of Bradley. And basically the idea is twofold. If you're a simulation enthusiast, so probably most people listening to this chat right now, if you're a simulation enthusiast, You want to meet other people. You want to see the exhibitors that are out there. You want to maybe learn a little more about what other simulations or what other developments are coming up. That's probably the biggest reason for you. We've got 31 exhibitors confirmed, 26 sponsors, 15 different speakers, and the majority of those folks are designed to, are setting up to bring people who are really into flights and really interested in simulation and tell you about maybe what the latest developments are, whether it be in VR, whether it be in what they're about to release, whether it be in a simulation platform. So that's about half the attendees. The other half are people who are pilots. Now, they may be people who have done some sim before, but probably not gone as detailed and as in-depth as some of the other group. So we're looking at people who may have had some experience, or maybe they've never had any experience at all. And we're trying to show them through these demonstrations and through the exhibitors what at-home flight simulation can do. And it's exactly the stuff that you and Jeff were just talking about, the real benefits for a real-world pilot who's in training or who's doing their IFR, or perhaps who's had an IFR but maybe let it lapse. That's what we're trying to show, is what simulation can do for those guys. So our target is about 50-50. We're really hoping, though, for the simulation community to make a big statement here. I mean, we need people, particularly from the U.S., to come out to this event and to be able to support it, for it to keep growing.
Now, are you getting a lot of foreign companies that are flying out for this?
Yeah, actually, I'd say it's almost like sometimes the interest from Europe is higher than it is from North America.
Yeah.
I think we've got more of the big European names here in North America than the European conferences do. I mean, we've got Aerosoft coming out, Dovetail Games. We've got, you know, just an incredible amount of support from Europe. And in fact, there's like people who fly across from like Germany and from parts of the Netherlands. And you're like, you guys made this trip and I can't get people from 20 minutes away to drive here? Really?
Well, it's crazy. I've been coordinating travel with three people from the UK. And
yeah.
I know a few folks mentioned it to me, but Squirrel today announced on his stream that he's going to be in attendance. And do you know who Squirrel is? Paul. I don't know Paul's last name.
No, I don't know.
Okay, he hasn't reached out to you. So he's a huge Euro Truck Simulator guy. And
he's a flight sim guy too.
He's a flight sim guy too.
Can everybody into one thing. People are like, you're a GTA YouTuber.
He'll say he's simulations home on YouTube. But I've been talking to Paul over the last few weeks, and he's coming out, and that's awesome. Like, Paul has, you know, you and Jeff, you as well, obviously, but you guys have such huge reaches. But like, the fact that we'll get to meet some folks from across the pond is really neat. And like, Dirk is coming over. Sorcerer Dave's still talking about trying to get over here. So like, I know, like, as far as the folks that I know, we've definitely got some folks from the EU coming, and that has me super excited.
Yeah, I think, you know, every time I talk about any kind of the European events, I mean, they do these conferences in Europe, and it's like, some of them are held at places where there's no internet, and sometimes there's almost no power, or there's very little power, like they can't even have a computer there, and there's like thousands of people. You look at these photos, and there's thousands of people at these events.
Yeah.
I was talking to Robert Randazzo from PMDG a couple of years ago when he was at FlightSimCon, and he's telling me that like, he walks into a room in a European conference and he's mobbed. Like, the second he's in there, everyone knows who he is. They're looking for like autographs. I mean, they're basically celebrities. And then here we are in the US, and you know, like, the simulation culture in the US is like, if you're a simmer, you're in your parents' basement. And we're trying to get people out of that, because quite frankly, that's not the case. And of course, we know what simulation can do for people. So we're really trying to just expand and get to that same mentality in the US of, let's have 1,000 people, let's have 2,000 people. We know we can do it. We've got the population for it. And so it's a matter of really getting people, in many cases, off of their computers and coming out to an event like this to start meeting up in person and to show that we are a real community.
So you mentioned folks 20 minutes away who aren't going. I think we're jumping the gun a little bit here, but like, talk about how one can get to Bradley.
Well, I mean, it's real easy to do if you're in the area. Of course, it's pretty easy to drive to, you know, a couple hours basically out of either Boston or New York. If you're flying there commercially, we recommend going right into Bradley. You know, it's got nonstop service from a number of destinations, pretty much all the major hubs in the U.S. They've got a number of nonstops now from the West Coast. San Francisco and L.A. both have nonstop flights into Bradley now. And very interestingly, Aer Lingus, who's one of our actually sponsors this year,
has got
a nonstop transatlantic flight now. So anyone coming across from Europe, if you go via Dublin, you can fly right into Bradley, which is really awesome. So we're excited to have them on board as a sponsor, and they've actually also been able to do some work for some of the folks coming across. So if there's anyone who's listening and is interested in coming across via Aer Lingus, I may be able to get you a bit of a discount on airfare. So if you can maybe reach out through Ty or whatever, there's a few things that they've been able to offer to some of the close sponsors, and I think we could probably extend that to the odd to the odd person as well.
Yeah, if that's the case, just shoot me a message, or myself or Jeff a message, and we'll get you forwarded on. That's pretty. Yeah. That'd be pretty sweet.
Yeah, so really excited for them to be helping out. Go ahead, Jeff.
The day after FlightSimCon, I'm going to Spain, and I'm actually going to be getting on that Aer Lingus airplane, going direct to Dublin, and then on to Barcelona.
Oh, very nice. And then, of course, for anyone who's flying in themselves, we've got to deal with Signature now this year at Bradley. So, once again, if people wanted to fly in themselves, there's no airport fees, no ramp fees, and they're doing $1 off fuel. All you need to do is just purchase a little bit of fuel at that discounted rate, and they'll do free transportation right over to the hotel as well. So anyone that's flying in, whether they're coming themselves or they're flying commercially, I mean, the nice thing is this event is at the hotel. You don't have to go anywhere. You literally can walk out of the airport into the hotel. It's in the same building, and you're there. And we are taking over the entire hotel. Now, of course, if you're driving, I'm pretty just, you know, Google your way over there. And I would say anyone that's flying in themselves, definitely to let us know and to make sure that they reserve a signature in advance. They'll need to let them know they're coming with FlightSimCon. And, of course, the more people that do that, the more we have the ability to negotiate those deals again for future years.
Absolutely. That's pretty cool. Yeah, and I think actually the Sheraton's all booked out now.
It is, yeah. So we're very excited to basically, it's just us. Like, we're literally going to take over the entire hotel. Every room, every exhibitor room, every exhibitor space, the hallways, that's going to be FlightSimCon. And it's been sold out now for about a week and a half, which is really exciting.
I'm definitely glad that I got my room booked when I did. Because, like, yeah, I think, like, some of the folks I mentioned a few minutes ago are all having to book it, like, the Holiday Inn of the Days and whatever else is in the area.
Yeah, I get the feeling that some of those are going to become like secondary FlightSimCon hotels too, though, at this point, because there's just so many people coming to this event.
We'll figure out which one's got the best bar.
Exactly.
We're all going to migrate there. Who's got the best drinks?
I hear good things about Bobby V's. 21 plus, of course, but Bobby V's around the corner. Yeah.
Was that the... I'll have to go look that up. Jeff, that wasn't where we went last year, was it?
I don't think so.
Every year, I know the guys from Jetline go out there, and I think usually DeAndre from Air Daily's out there with them as well. And every year, they always ask me, and I'm like, ah, I've got to do the conference dinner and yada, yada, yada. So I hear good things, though.
Not this year.
Not this year, no. So I'm saying I want my invite now.
Okay, here's a question.
Well, actually, the bar inside of the Sheraton was actually really good.
Yeah, dude, that was fantastic. Here's a question for the Cessna experts. Is there a defroster?
Of course.
Where the hell is it? My windows are fogging up.
Yeah, it's your heat.
Just pull my heat. Pull your heat. Whatever, I'll pull the heat. Okay, sorry, continue. Oh, we can't see anything. That's great.
Yeah, I thought you were an IMC there for a while.
No, It's cool. We're just, you know, I sent it over to Kavik and the windows are fogging up, but that's fine.
Yeah, and you can tell because the condensation on the instruments themselves.
Is that what that is?
Yeah.
Oh, it is. It's actually getting cold. It's icing up.
It's getting cold. It's icing up in there, man.
I'm looking at those thinking those are graphical glitches.
No.
I'm sorry. Well, you know, expert pro pilot. I don't know why anybody watches this crap. Like, why do you guys tune in?
Yeah, I know, right?
So we talked about getting to the event. What's new this year? What's different this year from last year?
We'll get a whole bunch of new speakers this year. And that's probably the biggest thing that changes year to year is basically what we do with speaking. Probably the biggest one I want to highlight, and this is something that I don't think many of the other conferences have been able to do, is we've got all three of the main flight sim developers that are not only going to be there, but they're all going to be on a panel discussion together. And as I said the other day, I feel bad for whoever has to moderate that, because it's going to be interesting.
That is going
to
be amazing. Well, yeah, to see... see
so just to jog my memory, who are the main three developers?
So we've got Austin, yeah, like you mentioned, he'll be representing X-Plane, of course, from Laminar Research. We'll have Rob McCarthy there from Prepared, Lockheed Martin Software.
Ooh, okay.
And then Dovetail Games, we don't know exactly who's going to be on the panel. I know Amy will be there again this year. She's been there for the past several years. I'm not sure if she'll be on the panel. But it'll be Dovetail Games talking about what they've got. It'll be Prepared talking about whatever 64-bit, we hope, version is coming out of that at some point in the future. And then it'll be Austin from X-Plane talking about a new release on their side as well. So it should be very interesting. We're just in the process of working out the logistics on that one right now.
Laminar's been hinting at native VR support. And that's
We'll have to see. I can't drop any bombs right now, but we'll have to see how that goes. So they'll be there both in that demonstration or the panel discussion, I should say, and then they're also doing their own thing at the event as well. So there'll be about an hour for them to have in the main room. So you'll have lots of opportunity to talk to X-Plane. We've got another couple of interesting ones that are going on with some real-world pilots, some guys that are both pilots for commercial airlines. One's at SkyWest, another one looks like a 777 captain, and they basically are talking about, you know, the interaction of real-world and flight sim. So there's one that we're looking at. It's actually not on the website yet, but it looks like it's going to happen through the airline to sim add-on, basically, and the guy, you know, okay, is a real-world 777 captain, and he's going to talk about what's it like flying the PMDG 777, and how does it differ, and sort of what are some of the things that are a little bit different between those two.
That's pretty cool. Do you know who that is?
Stuff there. I don't have a name on hand. I can probably find it here, but...
Nah, it's fine.
Yeah. It'll be up on the website, though, pretty soon. And then, of course, we're excited to have a lot of the mainstays that have been there several years coming back. So, you know, you're talking earlier about having to bring your stuff all the way down to the conference, and we thought maybe think about Tom Govan, who brings up his, like, literally Cessna 172 fuselage sim pit every single year. And every year it seems like I'm the one who's, like, pushing that thing into the U-Haul truck at the end. So I could tell you it's a bit of a nightmare to try and get it. But,
We tried to fly that last year.
Yeah, it was Cessna. Broken, unfortunately.
Oh, was it at the time that
you guys were
there?
At the very end of the event, they were having some problems with it.
Okay. Yeah, it's quite a cool thing. I mean, it obviously takes quite a bit to make it all work properly. But he's got projectors. He's got the actual sim pit. And last year, I tried to be nice to him because David Clark's one of our sponsors, and they gave us a bunch of headsets, and they were like USB Connect headsets. And I'm like, oh, this will be great. I can give him this for his sim pit. So I walk over there, and he's like, it's got a USB port on the end of it. That's not going to work.
Oops.
Yeah, I know, right? And I'm like, well, can't you just figure it out? He's like, nothing that goes in this plane is going in there unless it can go in the real plane. It's got USB, it doesn't go in.
Yeah. Dude, that's crazy. That's pretty cool. I got a couple questions from chat, if you don't mind.
Yeah, for sure.
So HeliPilot asks if there's going to be any DCS content.
I have been reaching out. I think for them it's a little bit tough because it's the day after or the day before the E3 conference, so it's a bit tough to make both work, but I've been reaching out and we're hoping to have an answer on that soon.
Okay.
If there is... And if Matt's able to attend, it will be probably just him attending. I don't know that they'll be able to do much in the way of exhibiting again because of the proximity of the conference that's happening right after ours.
What's the other conference?
E3, I think.
Oh, yeah, E3. Oh, yeah, that's like a week or two after.
It's right close by, yeah, and he's like, you know, I can do one or the other. Yeah, theirs is June 13th, so it's just a couple of days after.
Oh, jeez, yeah.
So I'm trying to make it work, and we've been trying. I think next year for sure, but I'm really hoping to see some DCS. I know that was a point that was brought up last year in feedback, so we have been reaching out and trying to make something work there, but it's, you know, it's tough for a lot of these people, particularly a lot of flight sim developers. You know, this isn't a full-time job for them, right? So it's like they've got to work out travel and logistics and family and everything else, and so just the support we've had has been great to see. Like, it takes a big commitment to attend. Same as an attendee.
Polytoxamaniac at me... Let's try that again. Polytoxamaniac asks if there will be an online stream of the panel discussions.
I'm sure someone is going to do it.
Probably after the fact, right? Recorded
video. Yeah, I know last year, basically, you could find anything online. So, I mean, we as a conference make a point of not really trying to do that because we want people to show up. And I think, you know, it's really hard, especially in some of these rooms. Like, we aren't wired and we don't have the budget to be able to make, like, a real professional quality. And we don't want to do it unless it's going to be decent. But I think you'll find, as with last year, that people just were recording on their phones or were recording with their cameras. And there was quite a bit of stuff on YouTube after the event. So I'm sure you'll be able to hear it.
Nice. Any other speakers or panels that you want to talk about?
Well, I mean, I think you guys might want to talk about what you're doing.
Sure. So we got, I got two things that's cooking right now. So I'll start with the first that we've talked about a little bit. We will be live streaming from the event, assuming the internet connection and the powers that be and whomever is the holy being up in the sky allows us to. The goal is to take all of my equipment down there and live stream from the event. I have a number of people who have committed to joining us. And there's a few other people whom I have asked that have tentatively said yes. So we should have a pretty good combination of personalities and people that'll be there. Talking to Evan previously, we were hoping that maybe some of the developers or some folks that are exhibitors and whatnot might be willing to stop by and say hello and kind of talk to the chat and have a little bit of an interview and this and that. So the goal for us is to be live nearly as much as. Like nearly as long as the show's going, with some obviously there's going to be some exceptions here and there, and the cool thing about what we're doing is that we've worked it out so that I'm doing a joint double booth with Pilot Edge, so I'm trying to convince Keith that he should get one of his controllers who is going to go to come and stream as well, For a block of time. So we might get some dueling banjos going at some point with the controller and somebody flying on the sim as well. But if you guys are going to the event, do stop and find us. I think we're up on the second floor. We're kind of off. Where would you say we're at, Evan?
Well, it may depend a little bit on how everything plays out, but right now it looks like you'll be right on the sort of on the middle of the second floor. So how it's going to be for those who were at the event last year, you know, the hotel, there's two different floors. There's a main floor that's going to have the main speaking area, which is a 350-seat ballroom, as well as a secondary speaking room, which will be a bit smaller, about 120 seats. And there'll be a couple of the exhibitors that'll be on that floor. Some of the bigger stuff, Tom Govan Simpit, for example, will be right down there on the main floor. X-Plane will be right down there on the main floor, just in front of that big ballroom area. And then up on the second floor, we've got a couple of different exhibitor areas there as well. So the main area will be the Amelia room, which is where we held the social last year. Be about 10-15 exhibitors in there, and it's a beautiful room. It's literally got these floor to ceiling windows where you're looking out on the tarmac at the airport. So I mean, you know, people talk about an event like, it's not like an airport hotel where you're like, oh, I'm in some ballroom and there's no windows. It's like, no, I'm in the control tower. You know, it's basically how it looks.
Yeah, Bradley, that ballroom, I will tell you, is awesome. Like, that was such a cool place to have the social the last couple years.
Yeah, and then just as you walk outside of that room, there's a hallway. There's a number of sort of smaller meeting rooms that'll have exhibitors in them as well. And you guys, right beside Pilot Edge, will just be in that hallway there. So if you're looking for us, second floor, have a stroll around the hallway, and you'll find Ty. You'll also find Boston Virtual ARTCC up there and some of the other flight simulation communities as well.
I was going to say, I think you guys are having your big VAT sim room up there as well, aren't you?
That's right, yeah. VAT sim's got a spot in that area too.
That's pretty cool. So yeah, we'll be up on the second floor. So do swing by, do say hello. Like I said, it's going to be live and raw, and you'll get to see how the sausage is made. And we maybe, like, if we run out of things to talk about, we'll just be like, hey, you over there, come over here, sit down, put the headset on, let's have a chat real quick. It may happen, who knows? So then the second thing that's going to go on, the second panel that we're doing, AeroSim Gaming, Rush Allen, however you happen to know him, is throwing together or getting folks together for a flight simulation streaming panel. So we have a few people that have committed to it that'll be jumping in. I think Keith Smith from Pilot Edge will be one of the guys there, talking about things from a business angle. AeroSim will be there as well. I believe Jeff has said he would talk. If he's not going to, that's fine. We'll put him on the spot, and then possibly like one or two other people. And then myself, I'm going to be moderating that panel. So the goal is to take an hour, take some pointed questions about at the folks that are sitting on the panel, talking about how streaming has kind of impacted them, how streaming has impacted their life, their business, you know, whatever else, and kind of talk about streaming specifically, how it differs from the YouTube side of things, and you know, how it can kind of coexist and work alongside some of the curated and edited content that's out there. And I'm particularly excited to have Jeff on there, because Jeff can kind of talk about it from both angles, where his business is focused on not just the, you know, edited stuff and the highly edited stuff, but also has a very live slant to it right now. And I think flight simulation offers, and we you know, you guys that tune in know this, like, flight simulation offers a pretty interesting it's a pretty interesting topic for live streaming, because like, these flights that we're doing don't really condense very well down to a 25-minute canned YouTube video like you would expect to see. And the possibilities for interaction and, you know, a conversation like we're having today, where it's like, I'm poorly flying a Cessna 172 and we're having a little bit of a conversation here about, you know, an event that's coming up. Like, that's something that's just not, you don't get that same sort of thing happening. So I don't know when that panel actually is, but it'll be on the schedule. So
I can answer that.
Okay. When is the panel?
It will be on day one, so on Saturday.
Okay.
It is in the Simsbury Room at 11:30 a.m.
So 11:30 a.m. on Saturday, we're going to have that panel. And do show up. And in addition to me asking questions of the folks on the panel, we also plan to open it up to the floor, too, for folks that have questions. And I expect there's going to be a fairly decent turnout of folks showing up for that, just because of some of the personalities and whatnot that will be there. And you know what? If not, then, hey, I'll pretend to sign autographs or something. We'll throw paper airplanes. Like, we'll find some way to make the damn thing entertaining. I don't have a plane to crash, but I'm sure we can, you know, we can ad-lib that. But definitely looking forward to that panel. I was excited when Alan talked to me about that and mentioned that he was trying to put something together. So yeah, that's pretty cool. I saw one question in chat. I didn't catch. Zero Mike Whiskey says, is it worth attending for just a couple of hours?
Yeah, I think I would say so. I mean, we've set up that way. We have a day rate available for people who only wanted to be there for a couple hours for one day versus the other. It's basically half price. So that is available to people as well in the registration options. I mean, I found that for me, you know, and this event, this is like my Christmas and New Year's and everything all rolled into one. So sorry for anyone who's Jewish. I'm half Jewish, so I can say that. But yeah, I mean, you know, for me, it's like I can't get enough of this. So for me, 2 days isn't enough. And I find I'm running around trying to get into every single seminar and presentation best I can. Yeah. But I think if you were just there for a day or for a couple hours, I think you'd find it really interesting. I mean, just to go around and see some of the exhibitors, you'll be able to, anyone who registers is going to get this goodie bag. Last year we had like mugs and pens and there were discounts available. Like Rex gave a 50% off coupon, I think, for anything on their store. And other people did the same kind of thing. So I think there's a real opportunity just in the savings alone to be able to be there and then to just do a quick tour, see who's there, meet some of these folks. I think it'd probably be worth it. Yeah,
and I'll say from personal experience, 2 years ago I went to the event for one day. We rolled in, you know, beginning of the event, saw the keynotes and all that, and kind of rolled out after the social, and I was immensely disappointed that I just didn't do both days. Like, I really, like, after that, I was like, why the hell didn't I do this? Like, I should have just stuck around for 2 days because I well and truly had a good time. And then last year, there was no question about it. Like, I was absolutely going to go down there for 2 days and 2.5 days, I guess, if you count Friday, and have a good time. But
you just can't see everything all in one day.
Yeah, I think that's right.
But even for a few hours, you'll still get the opportunity to, you know, fill your goodie bag up. Go around, see some vendors, see some really cool simulations, like the gentleman who's bringing his replica 172 simulator. Like, that thing, you have to see it to believe it. Like, it's nuts. It's absolutely insane. And him and his wife and his daughter and his, like, the whole damn family is so behind and so into this thing. It's just like, dude, I could talk to you all day.
Yeah, he's a great guy. And then you've got, like, stuff like the fly-in side last year had this setup where you could try VR.
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, you know, the whole time you had a lineup of 5 or 6 people waiting and you put the goggles on and you fly. And I didn't get to do it. And everyone, like, the whole time everyone's like, you have to go to this thing. You have to try it. You won't believe it unless you try it. I'm like, okay, I will. And then, of course, I never ended up going to it. But what everyone tells me is that they put on the goggles and they tried VR with flights and they're like, holy crap, I never want to go back.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. I got a little motion sickness, but that's probably for other reasons.
For sure, I think, you know, that kind of stuff is stuff that you can go there and try and enjoy for even an hour or two. Mm-hmm. And I think you don't get that just with your own home simulator. Plus, you can see what else is out there. I mean, you just walk around BVA setup. We have, I think, about, you know, usually 20, 30 guys that bring their own at-home setups. And they range from, like, a laptop and a joystick to Dana Atwood has got this, like, crazy thing where he's built a custom desk. And he's got an iPad mounted into it. And he's got 3 monitors and every single, you know, joystick and button panel you can imagine. And yep. He's built this really, really nice Beechcraft Baron cockpit. It's not like a home cockpit the way that Tom Govan's setup is, but it's a really, really neat simulator. And again, just to fly that for 5-10 minutes and see what it's like and pick up a couple of tips, I think is worth it.
Yeah, and like you'll be able to find us roaming the floor. You know, if anybody wants to stop by and say hello, not to, you know, be the narcissistic person, but hey, I'm going to do it because it's my stream. There'll definitely be an opportunity to see myself and Jeff and Squirrel and all sorts of other guys that are just kind of either at a booth or roaming or whatever. And like for me, that's a really cool part too, is to meet those people. And so even if you're going for a couple of hours, you can easily do all that stuff.
Yeah, for sure.
You know, I recommend it. Like I wouldn't be offering Evan the airtime if I didn't like firmly believe that everybody should go do this thing.
Yeah, so, well, I think we appreciate that. And I think, again, like what we need to do is we need to build ourselves up in North America to what's happening in Europe. Because
right.
I still, you know, I'm not going to comment on specifics, but we reached out to, you know, easily 300-400 people when it comes to exhibiting at this event, right? And we reach out to everyone you can possibly imagine. You know, if you think of a name and you're like, why aren't they there? We reached out and we either didn't get an answer or they said no. I'm not going to talk about specific people,
yeah,
but the thing is, the more we get at this conference, the more support that we get, the more exhibitors we bring in next year. And so if we want to see a simulation event happening in North America, we need to see people coming out to these events. You know, it's like what happened with the AvSim conferences back several years ago. We're seeing a tremendous amount of interest. We're seeing a tremendous amount of growth. The more people that keep on adding on to that, the more we have in our in our arsenal next year. We're going to these people and saying, hey, we had 500 people in, 2015, or we had 2016 rather, and, we're hoping to say we had 700 plus people in 2017, and then next year, we go for 1,000.
Yeah, for sure, man. Like, I'm yeah, gonna be a lot of people. I think the fact that the hotel sold out so early is indicative of what's going on there.
Yeah, I totally agree. I was not expecting that to happen. Quite frankly, I wasn't expecting that to happen at all. But for it to happen this soon, we're still 2 months away from the conference. It's great.
Broad AG, that is built into the plane itself. He asked about small head movements when I'm sort of moving the plane around, and that's the model itself has that. So I wanted to. Oh yeah, one thing that Aerosim wanted me to mention is that we're going to be arranging meet and greet times as well for the streamers. We're basically going to say, like, at this point at the booth, we're doing a big meet and greet. Come by, say hello, and all that stuff too. So, and I think actually we're trying to do something after the panel as well for that. Maybe that will be after the panel. But again, narcissism, man, narcissism. That's what it's all about, Evan. If you want to get ahead in the world of streaming video and in YouTubing, you have to be 100% sold on yourself, right, Jeff?
That's like the preview of your panel discussion, I think.
Some people are in love with themselves, but I surely am not.
Well, it's okay. I'm not going to say anything else because it'd be mean. So, Evan, you wanted to hit on an app that you have, right?
Yeah, we're super excited this year. We partnered with a conference app called Hoova, and I'd never heard of it myself until we started, but apparently it's quite a popular app for people who go to conferences on a regular basis. I don't know who those people are. I've never met anyone that does that, but apparently they exist. Anyway, this app is actually fantastic. I downloaded it a couple of weeks ago, and I'm going through it. It's basically everything FlightSimCon on your phone. So you download the app just from the regular app store, whatever you use, download the Hoova app, you connect to the FlightSimCon event. If you've already registered, when you actually open up Hoova, it knows that, so it'll automatically pair you with the event. If you haven't yet, it'll allow you to just enter a code and you can request access and get into it. And then everything about the event is on there. So all the attendees are there. You can message anyone you want. You can exchange contact information. There's like a general bulletin board where people are all saying hello to each other. You've got the agenda. You've got all the exhibitors, a map of the location, and then we're also going to be using it for a number of different contests and games throughout the event. So we're actually really happy this year. We've had a number of great in-kind supporters. We're going to have headsets to give away from Track IR, also headsets from David Clark. Imagine Sim, Just Planes, and Big Fat Simulations have all donated a bunch of product that we're going to be able to give away.
Nice.
We just, not on the website yet, just announced that we're going to have 5 sets of the Navigraph Ultimate subscription for 3 months to give away.
Cool.
And there'll be a few codes, it looks like, from Flight One as well for their product. So lots of stuff that we'll be giving away, and some of it will be through Hoova. And it's just like really cool things where you can like put a picture up and the person with the most likes on the picture wins. Or you can do different contests and trying to find things. So keep an eye out on that for... That'll be coming up, I guess, as we get closer to the event. And then we've also got the ability...
Continue, sorry.
I want to say no. And then, of course, we also got the ability to do messaging through there. So if there's a, this panel discussion is happening now,
nice.
Or, Ty wants to announce that he's having his meet and greet at 3 o'clock at his booth, that's something that can come out through the app. So we really encourage anyone that's attending to go and download it right now, put it on your phone, and have it there, because it will be your key to basically everything at the event, including the agenda for the whole weekend.
Nice. So is that something you can get right now and get set up?
Yeah, exactly. Just download Hoova right on your phone. And once you've got it, as I say, if you're already registered with the conference, if you register with Hoova using the same information, it will pair you with your conference registration and you'll be right in. And if not, then you can just request access. But definitely I'm encouraging anyone who's attending or thinking of attend to download Hoova right now and get yourself on there so that you're able to stay in touch with the latest updates from the conference.
Nice. Yeah, I'll go check that out.
Yeah, it's a great app.
I don't usually use those conference apps, but I think in this case it might be all right.
Yeah, it's really neat. You can see all the attendees that are going, and like people are asking me questions about like where is this going to be or where is that going to be. So it's just a nice way to be able to interact with everyone from the conference.
Cool. So you talked a little bit about giveaways. I guess the last point we have is registration, logistics, how to get there, and whatever else you got for advanced check-in. You doing?
Yeah, for sure. So basically, people, if they haven't registered yet, I know there was a question on about, can you register on the day of? The answer is yes. If you choose to do that, you will pay more money. than you need to, and probably you won't get a conference bag. Last year we had a whole bunch of people walk up to the event, and you know, of course we recognize that you can't always make your plans in advance, but it does really give us a challenge operationally to be able to handle, you know, 50 or 100 walk-ins. We're just not set up for that. So we really would encourage people to register online. You can do that on our website, www.flightsimcon.com. And you've got the registration rates right there. It's $60 for the weekend up until May 15th, $30 if you wanted to come for just one day or a couple hours. And then once we get past May 15th, the prices are going up again. So really encourage people to register early to get the discount, because, again, the more people that we have registered, the more leverage we have with our sponsors and our exhibitors to be able to give you guys the best experience. So that's the best way to register, is right on our website. You can register at the day of if you need to, but we're just trying to discourage that. And, of course, there are discounts available online as well, and discounts for students or student pilots. So someone like Ty, who's in their flight training, you guys are going to get a $10 discount off the regular registration price.
All right. And so you mentioned also to me advanced check-in.
That's right. Yeah, thanks for the reminder. So we'll have this year something new. One of the other nice things about the hotel is we are able to have the hotel for a little bit longer. So for people who are coming in on Friday afternoon, Friday night, which I figure most people are, we'll have the advanced registration open that night. So you don't need to wait until Saturday morning to get your badge, or if you've bought one, to get your t-shirt. You can do that at 4 to 6 o'clock on Friday evening and be able to get yourself all registered. So you just show up on Saturday morning and come right into the product demonstration forum, which is the way we kick off the event on Saturday. I should talk about that too. We're excited to have, basically, we're going to give, I think it's about 7 or 8 people now that have signed up for this, and it's like you have 5 minutes to announce your latest product, go. And we're going to do them back to back to back with whoever it was that had signed up for that. So it'll be an opportunity for everyone to get a real quick overview of like what's the latest and greatest in flight sim, and then of course you'll be able to go and talk to those exhibitors throughout the course of the weekend.
Is that a panel? Is that during the opening, or when was that again? I missed that.
Yeah, right at the very beginning. It won't be okay. A panel. It'll literally be back to back to back. I'm thinking I'm going to buy a bell, and I'm going to just start like dinging it every time that Austin goes over his time. but
let's talk about all the cool stuff we got.
It'll literally be just a quick 5 minutes. They can talk about what the latest is that they've got, and then be able to address that in more detail at their booth. So we're going to give people 5 minutes up on the stage. They can chat real quick, and then it'll go on to the next person. And that'll be right at the very beginning of the event on Saturday.
Nice. That's pretty cool. So do you guys have stuff going on later on Sunday as well, like to try to keep people, to make people stick around?
I mean, yeah,
not to make people stick around, but you know what I mean.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, so Saturday is kind of our big flight simulation day as far as the theme goes. And then on Sunday, we focus a little bit more on the real world stuff. So we've got a number of really cool speakers. I mentioned Matthew Cannon, who's the SkyWest pilot. Mm-hmm. Right after him is Mike Collier, who's a real world dispatcher with American Airlines. And he's going to be talking about some of the flight dispatch things. So, you know, how do you plan routing? What about for people who are going across the pond? And then using some of the flight planner apps like PFPX. So that'll be what he talks about. Following that, we've got Adam Savansky from the Canadian Armed Forces. And he's a real-world tactical helicopter pilot, and he's talking about how the military uses simulation in some of their training and in their accident investigation as well. So Sunday afternoon, and well, I guess for the entire day on Sunday, you'll have more of a real-world type theme. We've got a couple that'll likely be added onto that list too as we get closer to the event. So that's what we have going on Sunday. I think, you know, usually Saturday is the bigger day, but I do find that sometimes on Sunday, if it's a bit of a quieter day as far as speakers go, it gives you an opportunity to actually go out and see people on the floor and be able to try out some of these things for yourself.
That's pretty cool. Yeah, so that's all the topics you gave me to hit on. Some of the questions I have though, like for you personally, how is this event been different to organize and set up compared to the last, you know, this is the fourth year, right?
It's our fifth year this year, actually. Yeah, I would say it's getting easier and easier every year. And that's because, you know, every year we have more and more partners that have said, you know, maybe last year they said, oh, you know what, this is great, I can't quite make it this year, but yeah, definitely next year. And then you reach out and they're like, oh yeah, I'm totally in. So it's been a lot easier for us to be able to get those exhibitors on board. People have come on board a little bit earlier, which has been nice for us this year. And the hotel's been a really great partner to work with as well, as far as the space that they're able to give us and the fact that we've been able to just take over the entire place. So I think from those perspectives, it's getting easier for us to do this kind of an event. And of course, people know about us now. So when we say FlightSimCon, a lot of people are like, oh yeah, as opposed to what?
Yeah, what's that?
Yeah, exactly.
Any plans? I'm assuming you guys have already thought ahead, you know, years and years and years. But do you think is it going to stay in the Hartford area for the foreseeable future?
It's hard to tell. We've looked at a number of different places. It's actually kind of difficult to find places to host these events because you've got to find a place that can do, you know, 7, 8, maybe 1,000 people, mm-hmm. but that's reasonably priced. And we're trying to keep our prices as low as we can. You know, we looked this year, for example, at moving up to Boston and doing the event there, bigger city and all that. And we're like, you know, it's going to be double the price for a hotel.
Yep.
The venue is going to be about 9 to 10 grand a day. And then you've got to figure out how to get from the airport to the hotel. So for someone who's looking to attend the event, it becomes double, if not triple, the price, not for necessarily the registration, but for all the other stuff that you need to do, like getting a hotel and stuff like that. So we're looking at that. We're always looking at that. I don't know. Personally, I think I'd like to see it move to a place that's a little bit of a bigger city and a bit easier to get to. You know, everyone always says, well, FlightSimCon on the West Coast, or when are you going to do something, you know, take the show on the road? You know, we'd like to do that if we can, but the logistics of something like that at 500 people, it's really difficult. So to answer those people, the thing is, you know, make the trip out to Bradley and help us get to 1,000 or 1,500 or 2,000 people, and it's a lot easier to say, yeah, you know what, we can go find a conference center in L.A. or Seattle or Denver, as someone's mentioning in the chat there. It's a lot easier for us to get to that point when we've got the attendees to be able to support it.
FlightSimCon Denver. Everybody loses their breath.
I was going to say,
dude, if we did FlightSimCon in Denver, we'd all be dead. Like, let me tell you, I don't know if you guys know, something about high altitude is that there's certain substances that have a real effect on you. And judging by the way last year went for a few of us, thanks, Alan. It was a good time.
I had a comment in the chat there. I just wanted to address as well for the spelling of HOVA. If you're wondering, it's WHOVA. Maybe someone who has a keyboard could maybe type that in the chat for people. If you're looking to download the app, HOVA, WHOVA.
HOVA.
HOVA.
Here we go. HOVA. HOVA. HOVA.
Like if you're saying the word Hoover with an accent.
HOVA. HOVA. HOVA.
There it is. Yeah, look at that.
Ask and ye shall receive. I know what I'm doing. Sorta. Is there anything else that you want to talk about, man? Anything else you want to hit on?
I think we've covered it. I mean, I'm happy to answer any questions that folks have in the chat there. If people are wondering about anything, I'm happy to answer. But yeah, I think basically the end result is, you know, you've really got to be there. It's a really cool event. I've been there all 5 years from when it was in a hotel ballroom with no windows with about 25 people, it felt like, the first year, up to what we saw last year with over 500. So the event is just an amazing opportunity. It's really the only opportunity we have in North America to get together. You're able to meet and be in the same room with all these developers who make all the products that we use on a day-to-day basis. So I just would encourage anyone who's on the fence to give it a try, to come out to the event, and basically let's get out of the basement and let's start talking to each other and let's start meeting people and be able to start to develop what they have in Europe, which is this culture of like FlightSim is cool, as opposed to, you know, FlightSim is something that you don't really want to tell most of your friends about.
I'll tell all my friends about it.
No, me too.
The difference is I'm making a little money off of it, so there's always that. If you guys have any questions, please do ask. Questions for myself, questions for Evan, questions for Jeff, you know, whatever. We're not doing any LSPDFR. We're not doing DOJ, so we'll just knock that out right now. Evan says he's going to...
737 there on the left of you?
I think that might be a 737, yeah. Well, you're on VATSIM, so, you know.
Yeah.
I think Evan said he's going to go control Boston Center here once he's done talking to us, so... If you guys want to keep your eye, if you guys want to get your Iron Mike award and keep him from getting on the comms, this is also the time to ask questions. Dan of Vermont asks about parking at the hotel.
Yes, parking will be free and it will be part of the event. You'll have lots of parking at the hotel, and then they have told us that they are working with the airport to deal with the overflow parking. So more information on the logistics is coming out closer to the event. Our plan is actually to send everyone an email about 2 weeks before the event with all the logistics details, so where to park and, you know, what time to check in and those kinds of things. But you'll have free parking, and the hotel parking lot, I'm sure, is going to fill up in about 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
Once that's done, then there will be other parking areas at the airport that they've arranged for us to be able to have people park. So shouldn't have any problem with parking, and it will be free.
Yeah, and I can attest, like, it's that airport's really easy to get to, and the parking of the hotel is fantastic. Like I've done it 2 years now, and I stayed there last year, and then the year before I met up for the social, and there were no issues whatsoever. Like, for as much as parking is a pain in the ass, and that's like the main thing we seem to care about up here in the Northeast, it's not too bad.
Yeah,
for this
it's
event.
A huge parking garage there.
Like, if you live within 2 hours of Windsor Locks, just like I would just drive. Like, I'm driving there from the Boston area, and it's a piece of cake. Like, there's really nothing to it.
Yeah, and it's very easy. Like, say, very easy to get to, and then for people who are flying in, of course, it's just a matter of walking. Like, you don't need a rental car or anything like that, because you can just walk into the hotel and everything's there. If you're staying in a nearby hotel, they've pretty much all got airport shuttles, so just say you're going to the airport and then, hey, you're at FlightSimCon. So that works out pretty nicely for people. I should mention as well, we were talking about the social. We haven't really mentioned that yet. So Saturday evening, another reason to stick around after the event on Saturday, we are having an after-event social. It'll be just in the main lobby area of the hotel there, and it is sponsored by Orbix, which is the top sponsor of our whole event. So Starbucks is giving you all free drinks and free food, so enjoy that. It'll be a just sort of like a light sort of snack type fare, and then you'll have complimentary drinks as well as some alcoholic stuff for those who are 21 plus, so that's always nice. So that's the after event social on Saturday. We decided this year not to do an official conference dinner, mostly because I want to go to Bobby V's with the guys from Jetline Systems. So we'll be able to, for people who want to, there will be options for food at the hotel. I think they're doing a discounted dinner option for anyone that wants to stick around there. And, of course, there's lots of restaurants nearby. And then lunch as well at the hotel. Again, it's up to you if you wanted it, but there is an option for lunch. It's a pretty reasonably priced buffet lunch, as I recollect.
Yeah,
I think it's like $15 per person plus tax, so it's not too bad at all. And that'll be available in the hotel. Of course, there's lots of stuff in the terminal, and there are a number of restaurants that are nearby as well. So if you don't mind driving, I've actually walked to most of the nearby restaurants. Bit of an awkward walk because there's no sidewalk. But if you don't mind dodging your way through some cars, about a 20-minute walk away
it's
to
also like
some
a five,
of the restaurants.
It's like a $5 Uber as well.
Right.
We took an Uber... we took an Uber a few times last year getting around, and there was nothing to it. But and it's worth mentioning too. I'm sure this will happen. There'll be probably a ton of people doing this, but Friday night, myself and I'm sure Jeff and a number of other people will be down at the hotel bar pretty much all night.
Yeah.
So like, if you get there early, come on down and say hi, man. Like last year, we had an amazing crowd of probably 15-20 people over the course of the night. It just dropped in, and we crashed that bar for the night and just kind of had a good time. And almost certainly the same thing will end up happening on Saturday night, too. So if you're over 21, you know, drop in, say hello, have a drink.
If you have a fake ID and you're not over 21.
If you have a fake ID and you're not over 21, or even if you're not over 21, catch us when we're going to the bathroom. Because one thing you'll learn is that when you drink a lot of beer, you have to pee a lot. So, like, hey, I don't want to talk to you. Like, no, dude, like, just give me a second, okay? Just, like, just 2 minutes. And what, you can have my attention, just not right now. So, yeah. $15 for a meal isn't that bad. Expensive. That's expensive. Oh, yeah, dude. I think the breakfast buffet was like 10 or 15 bucks.
Yeah, I think that was
so,
like that.
One of the questions I've had from random people is how do I, like, basically talking about the hotel itself and kind of the event and whatnot. So it's worth noting that that hotel is actually attached to the airport. So any airport or any hotel that has an airport shuttle can get you to and from Bradley, no problem. Like, you can get off at the terminal, walk 50 feet down, and you'll be at the terminal, or you'll be at the hotel itself. And there's actually a walkway that connects, like an internal walkway that connects the terminal as well. So trolls because, you know, fat sim, right? It's worth kind of hitting on that because it's, you know, if you're not at the hotel and you're looking, you know, where should I stay? Anybody that has that shuttle, like you'll be just fine. Those shuttles will run pretty regularly, and as long as you can get to the airport, you can get you know, you can get to the hotel, get to the event.
And if you are going to the hotel, check in early and ask for an airport view because only half the rooms have it, and it is worth it.
I didn't get an airport view last year, but I'm going to get in. I'm planning on getting in pretty like wicked early on Friday. So.
It's definitely, I mean, you can make that request when you do the booking too, but it's really when they check you in that they'll give that. And I always ask for it. And actually the 1 year they put me on the other side and I'm like, nope, not going to stay there. You have to move me over. But it's great. Like really you are sitting there and it's like you're in the control tower. Like it's right on top of the terminal building pretty much. You're on the third, fourth floor. You've just got a phenomenal view of the airport. We all, just a bunch of us usually hang out in my room. We got a scanner and we just sit there and watch. It's great.
Nerds.
Yeah, I know, right?
Yeah, I remember
that's
seeing
the guy doing a flight sim stream. Yeah, okay.
Yeah, right. See, now you're getting the hang of it. Am I doing anything like the after this like X-Plane? Nah, this is probably going to be it today. It's going to be a nice short stream, and all that good stuff. Do a little flying of the Air Force Labs 172, Evan, are you an X-Plane guy at all?
You know what? I'm mostly a controller these days. I fly in real life as well now. It's my full-time job, so I've sort of... I don't want to say I've hung up the yoke completely, but I mostly do controlling these days and with the little bit of time I have. So I haven't done much X-Plane. I've wanted to get into it. I hear good things. Everyone that I've seen... You know, it used to be like when we did our first FlightSimCon, X-Plane was kind of this like thing that if you used it, you didn't really tell anyone, and it was like, you know, no one really knew how to use it. And I think now, in the past 5 years, it's really become... third, like a competitor, really, and it's like a lot of people use it. I find on VATSIM these days many, many more people using X-Plane than they ever were before, so it's good to see that.
Why do you think that is?
I think basically the biggest thing is in the X-Plane 10, I think, and also now with X-Plane 11, they're starting to make it a lot more usable.
Yeah, definitely. I was gonna say it's all the content creators, but yeah, that's a good one too.
I've never done it, but I've heard usability being the biggest challenge that people had, you know, absolutely. Back when it was 5 years ago.
And X-Plane 11 has gotten so much better in that regard. I got used to the old system, so I'm one of those haggard old guys that are just like, don't change my sim. But you know, now that I've had a chance to kind of play around with 11 and kind of get used to it, like it's definitely much, much, much better than what we had previously. Look at this grease. Oh, clean up on aisle 6 right there. Yeah. You guys will see it in a second.
Yeah, I was going to say.
You're still in the flare for me.
Well, you know, don't judge.
You know, I've flown on many airplanes, but of all the planes I've flown in real life, I think the 172 is the hardest to land that I've had to fly.
I left two 172 tire-sized holes in the runway this morning.
Yeah, I think we've all been there.
Hung my head in shame. Even the instructor looked at me, he's like, what the hell was... Like, he didn't say it, but he kind of looked at me like, what the hell was that?
Yeah, we've all been there.
Yeah, it happens.
It's all about the roundout, man. Once you master the roundout, you'll be golden.
Yep.
I'm gonna learn how to fly.
It's those first ones where you cut the power, and you're like,
right.
Because whenever I fly solo, I have a little bit of power in over the piano keys, depending on the airplane, because some airplanes are a little more finicky than others. But I like to have like just a little smidge of power in there just to grease that out. Because I want to have that there because, that engine lags as it is whenever you're flaring. So if you feel yourself dropping, you're gonna plunk into the ground. It's a guarantee.
Well, that's my next lesson is my instructor has promised me that the next 5 hours will be nothing but touch and goes and landings and takeoffs and more. And oh my. So there's that. So, hey, is there anything else either of you guys want to hit on? I don't see a lot of questions coming in from chat. So I think unless there's something else that you want to hit on, we can probably call it there.
Yeah, sounds good to me.
Let me turn this plane off real quick. Just, you know, unceremoniously pull the mixture, turn the thing off.
But of course.
Yeah.
Yeah, I hope to see everybody out at FlightSimCon. Should be a good time.
Yeah, I hope to see you guys all there. If you two want to stick around for a few minutes, I would be much appreciated. Appreciative.
For
sure. Everybody else, guys, I want to thank you all so much. It's a very short stream today, a little bit of a special stream. Big thanks to Jeff. Big thanks to Evan for coming and joining us today. I guess this is kind of Evan's idea, but thanks to Evan anyway for coming and joining us. I will be back sometime next week. I don't know when. There may be a stream. Actually, we might do something on Monday because I have Monday off. Either way, we'll definitely be live on Friday. Yes, be live on Friday because there's nothing going on that Friday. I look forward to see you guys then. Everybody have a great and wonderful weekend. If you're in Massachusetts, have a great and wonderful 3-day weekend. I think a lot of people in Europe also have the day off too. Let's see who we're going to go say hello to. There has to be somebody streaming. We got Valdudes. We're going to go say hi to Valdudes. So go drop some beer mugs on Valdudes, and we'll see you guys soon. So have a great night, have a great afternoon, whatever, and we'll see you when we see you. Toodles.
Bye bye.
You want to say bye, Evan?
Thanks for having us. Take care.
I'll see you guys in just a second.
Yeah,
hang on while I awkwardly find the button that has the music. There we go. Good night, guys.